and we were texting back and forth, I would say, pray. And they were praying and like shooting those scriptures right at Roger. I'm telling you, it was the best thing you ever seen. Peace and calmness and strength of the joy of the Lord. It was magnificent. It was unreal. So through those prayers, and they would shoot scriptures to us, just like a gun aiming at the very spot it needed to be shot at. And they went in there. It was amazing. Now, yes, he's healed in Jesus' name, and the manifestation is coming.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We can depend on God's word. It doesn't depend on how I feel. His word says it. I am healed. So I'm healed.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Yeah, you can do better than that. Give him a hand. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Who's excited about the word of God? You know, God is so, so good. I just love the Lord, and I just amazed sometimes at how God makes a way. This has been an insanely busy week, and in fact, I drove a field trip for Peterman this week, and it was such a blessing because I had my Bible. I ran into John, and it was just awesome. I mean, I got so much stuff just praying in the Holy Ghost, meditating the Word of God, and letting the Holy Spirit download on you. It's just such a blessing. The Word of God is so good, and no matter where you're at, I just went through one of my Bible college courses, and Wendell Parr was talking about how just realizing that you're the temple of the Holy Ghost, that God will never leave you. I mean, it isn't like, you know, he said so many churches we pray and we're thinking like, God, please show up, Holy Spirit, come. And it's just so unscriptural. That's an old covenant concept. God never leaves you nor forsakes you. He's always with you. You're anointed. Did you know that? The anointing doesn't come and go. And he asked a powerful question I thought was really good. He says, was Jesus more anointed when he was sleeping in the boat or when he was rebuking the storm? Think about it. Was he more anointed when he was sleeping in the boat or when he was rebuking the storm? Same. Amen. That's the correct answer. And it's like we think that we got to kind of conjure up and get in these things. And people think, well, I got to come in the meeting. I got to shut myself away and all that stuff. I love what Andrew always says. He says, you know, if I'm not ready now, I'm not going to be ready. And we need to live in that mode and realize that God is always with us. He doesn't check in and out. In the old covenant, that's how it was, because they weren't born again. So God could not indwell of some, you know, a sin nature, could not do it. There was no way. So the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament would come upon people for a moment to help them accomplish the task at hand. But in the New Covenant, you and I are the temple of the Holy Spirit. That's powerful. We need to be more God inside minded. Amen. That's awesome, isn't it? You know, people say, well, you know, I need my prayers to get to heaven or reach the throne room. You don't need your prayers to go past your nose. That's why you bow your head when you pray, because you're looking at God. And some of us look like we got more God than others, right? I'm kidding. All right. But God is good. Amen. And he's with us right now. We don't have to get him to show up. I love something Denny always says as a, you know, leading worship, and how he used to always feel like he had to conjure up a mood and get a mood and get people going and all that kind of stuff. But now he realizes that God is always there. And it's up to us to choose. Everybody say choose. We can respond or we can choose not to respond. And it's totally up to us. That's why Jesus sat down, not because he was tired, but because the work was finished. The only thing left now is for us to receive our glorified body. But everything's done as far as redemption is concerned. And we just need to act like it's true. And when I say act, I'm not saying put on a fakeness, but simply act upon what is already true. Amen? We are studying the seven churches in the book of Revelation. Who can name the first three without looking? Ephesus was the first one. Second, I heard it. Smyrna. Third, Pergamos. That tonight we're doing Thyatira. Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, and now we're going to do Thyatira. And in chapter 3, we'll be into Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. The next, I think it's next Thursday, will be the last Thursday of the year. And so we will do Sardis, and then after the healing school, we will pick up with Philadelphia and Laodicea. Very, very powerful. All seven of these churches are speaking to us. Did you know that? That's why he closes each church and he says, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying unto the churches. That's powerful. I'm finding more and more that hearing's just a matter of setting time aside and letting God speak to you. Amen? He'll talk all the time. But we need a time of intimacy to allow God. I always call it download time, whatever you want to call it. And I like to say it like this too. God will not speak up. He'll ask you to turn the world down. I'll say that again. God will not speak up, but he asks you to turn the world down. He speaks in a still small voice. And we need to know that because there's a lot of noise around us. And what I mean by noise, I'm not talking about just loud music or whatever, but just the people talk about. So I rarely listen to music, and I like music, but I like to focus on him. And I'll listen to a teaching, but I only listen to so much of that, and I turn it off because if something good is said, then all of a sudden I got to stop and meditate it. It's just so good. Amen? Amen. It's powerful. But I like to describe meditating, biblical meditation. It's not an Eastern thing, by the way. It's a God thing. And I believe it's listening. When you meditate the word, especially as you meditate the word, I like to pray in the Holy Ghost under my breath and meditate the word. And all of a sudden you just begin to see things. You say, man, when did that get put in the Bible? And I read something in Luke today. I was like, wow, that is so good. Now that answers a question I had. In other words, God is talking, God is speaking, but he speaks primarily through his word, and everything that he speaks that may not be directly in the word will always be within the, in the boundaries of God's word. He never speaks contrary to the word, never. And I want to, and we're going to get into some of the things that we're going to get into in the Church of Thyatira, but I'm also finding out that, well, I'll just wait. We'll just get into the Church of Thyatira because we're going to cover this when we get in there, and we'll just get started. Chapter 2 of Revelation and verse 18. I'll have my wife read beginning of verse 18. And I'm going to, every one of these churches, I'll say this. So.
And unto the angel of the Church of Thyatira write.
Stop. I say this every time. Angel. Anybody know the Greek word? Angelos. Very good. Angelos means messenger. Most of the time we think of an angel as just a celestial angel. But if you read at the end of the book of Revelation, John fell down before the angel. And he said, don't do it. I too am your fellow servant. In other words, I'm a man just like you. An angel does not necessarily have to be a celestial angel. It can be like Gabriel. But it can also be a messenger. And here almost every scholar you'll read, every theologian believes that when it says under the angel of the church of Ephesus, under the angel, everyone, that it's talking to the pastor or the presiding elder, whatever, the overseer. And what this tells me that people that are in charge of the word of God have a huge responsibility. Huge. And I say this, and I am learning more and more as I go through life. I'm learning that a lot of people, even churches, even pastors. I talked to a pastor recently, and they had some event going on and singing and all that stuff. And in my mind's going, did you get in the word? Did you have time to get in the word? And I've heard people say, well, we just sang the whole service. And I'm not against singing. I think it's great in worship, but you need the word of God. I'm telling you. And I know a lot of pastors that, oh, man, you know, so-and-so, hey, why don't you come to our church? Because they're trying to get out of preaching. I'm trying to get into it because I got so much to say. Amen? I mean, that's how powerful the word of God is. And I say it all the time. I said it to John today. And I'm not saying this to toot my horn. Hear my heart. I'm not. But the excitement in my life is the word of God. I'm telling you, it's exciting. This is the most awesome, awesome life you could have. It's in the word of God. Jesus is the word of God. Amen. So the more you see, the more the Holy Spirit guides you into truth and you begin to see even the correction. You say, well, that's not Jesus. Yes, it's all part of him and who he is and how much he loves you. Correction is because he loves us. Amen. It's a good thing. Amen. All right. So unto the angel or the pastor or the presiding elder of the church of Thyatira write. Now, I say this because I've heard somebody say already, well, this was written to the pastors, and it is because it says that. But at the end of each church, it says, he that has an ear, there it gets general, let him hear what the Spirit's saying unto the churches. So there's a responsibility both to those who are teaching, and in some regards, we all teach. You know that. People are watching your life. Wendell Parr said on that thing I was listening to today, he said something really good. He says, you could go in a store and you could stand at the counter and the born-again, spirit-filled Christians are complaining about the prices just as much as the secular people. He said, that ought not to be. I mean, we're of another planet. We ought to be so. And he also got on a soapbox that I like to get on there with him. He said church is compromising and becoming seeker sensitive instead of what God wants. Trying to reach people by becoming like them. That's like, I'm going to reach the drunk by going out and getting drunk. No, we need to be radically different, not offensive. We love all people and we welcome all people. That's not what we're saying. But what they need is Jesus, and he's the one. Jesus never compromised. Yet he was a friend of sinners, but he never compromised. They seen his love and acceptance, but they also seen he had something different. This guy's different. I want what he has. Amen. And that's the difference. So unto the angel of the church of Thyatira write.
These things saith the Son of God, who hath his eyes like unto a flame of fire, and his feet are like fine brass.
Eyes in the Greek, it's a Greek word that means, of course, the eye. Metaphorically, it means the eyes of the mind or the faculty of knowing. In other words, it's the faculty of knowing. And listen, as God goes through all these churches, and there's, for example, the church of Ephesus, he says, repent or else. Change your mind or else. He doesn't say you'll go to hell. He doesn't say that. He says, repent or else I will remove the candlestick. Chapter 1, verse 20 says the candlestick is the church out of his position of authority. So, you know, this mindset, and I'm going to get into this as we get further along, this mindset that says, well, I'm under grace, so it don't matter what I do. Well, listen, God's already judged sin, and you can approach God. But see, part of approaching God is receiving the empowering ability to not live that way. The Bible says it, and I won't go there for the sake of time, but it says, you hath he quickened, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 and 9. That means made alive. Who you used to be dead in trespasses and sins, where in a time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience. Now, this is an amazing truth. Are you ready for this? We all, before we came to Christ, we all thought we were doing our own thing. But according to that scripture, we were being led of devils. We thought we were free, but we were really in bondage. Isn't that amazing? Think about that. How many people out in the world, but how many people even in that think they're under grace aren't under grace? I will tell you, Jen and I, speaking through personal experience, we are experiencing people that have thought grace, well, you don't have to be in a church. It doesn't matter. You don't have to. God still loves you. But if you're not partaking of the brethren, 1 John chapter 1, verse 7 says, if we walk in the light as he is in the light, guess what? We have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. But oh, no, we're the church, brother. It's not the building. I get it. Okay, I get it. We're the church. Your cat's the church. Your fish is the church. Your dog's the church. Your goal, you know, all that's the church. You know, I get all that. A lot of that's just foolishness. Why did Paul say in the church? Yes, I get it. We're the church. But we need each other. We need fellowship. You need to be around people that aren't as perfect as you so you can help straighten them out. Now, amen. Write that down, brother. So I'm serious because her and I just had a situation recently. I mean, just almost a tragic situation, a relational situation where these people, and some of you would know, in the Word, could quote scripture, all those kind of things. But because they you know, you can't tell them anything. They know everything. You ever try to tell somebody something that knows everything? There's so many people today, they're becoming what I call spiritual teenagers. You've heard me say that. Teenagers get to the place where they know everything. You ever see, you know what I'm talking about? Yeah. And their parents know nothing. And then it's a few years later, they find out it's amazing how much their parents learn in just a couple short years. That's amazing. But you know, they do. And it's so vital that we're humble and that we're teachable and that we work together. Amen. It really is, because a lot of what people are calling grace is not grace. They're turning, Jude said it in Jude verse 4, they're turning the grace of God into lasciviousness. That's not grace. As Emerson always says, it's grace and truth. We need it all. And here again, you know, we need to appropriate the grace of God. And if we do, it's going to show up in our lifestyle. None of us do everything perfect. All of us miss it. I'm not talking about that. God's not mad at us. That's our saying. But the fact that God's not mad at us, guess what? I can constantly have relationship with him. He never leaves me nor forsakes me. Therefore, if I'm constantly having relationship with him, it's going to change me. I'm going to receive his grace and it's going to empower me. Hear that? That's awesome. Amen. Praise God. All right. So his eyes were as a flame of fire and his feet are like fine brass. I got to finish that one. Brass, this is just what I, as I prayed, brass in scripture usually has to do with judgment. I believe it's saying that God walked the judgment that we deserved. I believe that's what he's saying. And he always wants us to remember that. You know, Creflo Dollar, if you've seen him today, Emerson and Jen were telling me about it. Absolutely awesome. I did see most of it. I had to go, but it was phenomenal because he was talking about the love of God and how we, understanding that God loves us. And I love that saying, but God. I love that because, you know, even as we were walking around here, we were out here earlier doing a little exercise and walking, I was thinking, well, this, and this, but God. This, and this don't look, but God. But what about that? But God. Everybody say that together. But God. You know, I mean, I've literally seen that, and Kelly's not here tonight, but I seen that in a situation where we actually went through that when we was doing the bus thing. But God. But God. In a situation I never thought would have occurred, it occurred. That's how powerful the Lord is. That's how powerful. We need to begin to declare what God says. Amen? We need to begin to speak it and to say it. And because I'm telling you, the Bible says you have faith, but you release it through your mouth. And I'll tell you, the way a lot of people talk, they're not releasing faith that they have. Amen. Say, what's that? Yeah. But here's what I want you to see, and this is good, Doss. I'm glad you said that. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 13 says, we having the same spirit of faith, as it is written, we have believed, therefore we speak. Now watch this. That hit me like a ton of bricks one time. I always thought, well, I don't want to really say it if I don't believe it. He's saying if you're born again, you have faith. You believe it. Say it. Act upon it. However he leads you. Amen? That's simple. With the heart, man believes into righteousness. With the mouth, confession is made unto or into salvation. Romans 10:10. That's awesome. But boy, that's so simple. But how many people, I tell people, just begin to declare, man, I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Let's say it. I say, I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Say, I'm the temple of the Holy Ghost. God lives in me. God loves me. God's favor's on me. I'm as righteous as Jesus because it's his righteousness. Man, oh man, that's just so awesome to live like that and to declare like that and to not allow any garbage out your mouth. Listen, well, what if I do? This isn't a condemning thing. This is a challenging thing. It's saying, come up hither. But our mouth, death and life are not in the power of the Lord.
That's right.
And what's the rest of it? I've been meditating on the rest of it. They that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. You know what I believe that's saying? I thought, what in the world is that saying, Lord? So I Hebrewed it and did all the different things with it. And I thought, what is that saying? Death and life are in the power of the tongue. And they that love it, they realize the value of their words, shall eat the fruit of it, whether it's good or bad. Some people are so steeped in negative, they love to whine and negative, and they're reaping it. Amen? Think about that. Anyhow, that's a whole other subject. So, and notice what he says in verse 19 to the church, the angel of the church of Thyatira.
I know thy works in charity and service and faith and thy patience and thy works and the last to be more than the first.
This reminds me of the church of Ephesus. He starts off with commending them. This is a great lesson. He starts off with building them up. This is a real compliment here. But he says, first of all, he says, I know thy works, thy charity or love. I know your service, your faith, and your patience, or it's your endurance. And your works, he says, the works, and the last to be more than the first. In other words, they were increasing in works. I've heard people say, well, the last works are more than the first church. that I've heard that said. I mean, there's people have all different things, but I believe if you leave it in context, he's saying that they were increasing in their works, which means they were increasing in grace. Because grace produces works. If you understand grace, you're ordained to good works. See, people don't say that. This isn't talking about dead works or works you offer up to try to be right with God. This is talking about responding to the righteousness you already are. Do you know you're ordained to good works? Go to Titus 2:14, if you would, please. Titus chapter 2, verse 14. And I'll give you Titus 1:16 while she's going there. Titus chapter 1, verse 16, talking about the Cretans, which was an island, Crete, and Paul telling Titus that they profess that they know God, but in works they deny him, being disobedient and being abominable, disobedient unto every good work reprobate. In other words, these Christians were saying, hey, we know God. But their works were contrary to who they said they knew. It'd be like me saying, I love my wife, but I treat her bad. Something's not right. I obviously don't love her, even though I'm saying I do. Amen? Now look at Titus 2:14. First of all, verses 12 and 13 talk about the grace of God. And he talks about the grace of God in verses, 11 and 12. And then read 13 and 14. I think that's what it is.
13. Looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purifying unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works.
Zealous of good works. And go to 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians 15, do that one. So the Bible says that God redeemed a people in himself. They were zealous of good works because that's who they are. Amen, Anita. They said they professed that they knew God. If you read that same chapter 1, there's only 3 chapters in the book of Titus, but in chapter 1, he says, there's a witness that says they're evil beasts, slow bellies, lazy gluttons. And Paul said, this witness is true. He told Titus, this witness is true. That wherefore, rebuke them sharply that they may be sound in the faith. And he closes out chapter 1 and verse 16 by saying, they're saying they know God, but their works deny that they know God. I said it like this. I think I said it last week or the week before. You can do good works and not believe. But you cannot believe and do good work and not do good works. I'll say that again. You can do things. That's why he talks about, that's why God's judging their works, why they do what they do. See, God's more interested in why you do what you do than what you do. This isn't for heaven and hell issue. That's not what he's talking about. Because we're saved by grace through faith. We're saved by what Jesus did, period. And we walk by what Jesus did, period. But that will produce good works. See, it's easy to get into dead works to where you think like, well, I'm doing this, now God's going to bless me. Truth is, God's already blessed you. And boy, we got to see that God already loves you. You can't do anything to make God love you more. Nothing. That's powerful. But when you realize he loves you, that's the motivation. I'll give you the scripture. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14 says, the love of Christ constrains us, compels us, motivates us. That's the motivation in the new covenant, love. The motivation in the old covenant was fear of punishment or promise of reward. That was the motivation in the old covenant. But in the new covenant, the motivation is the love of God. The love of Christ will absolutely constrain you. It will compel you. It will motivate you. Amen? See, a lot of people don't think it. Because some people have been so law, law, law. And all of a sudden you take the law off and this is great. And you know, a person I was talking to recently was just like, well, you know, people get lazy. Amen? They do. It's easy to get lazy and, well, I don't want to do it. But see, it's also dangerous. God's already judged you. But there's all kinds of junk in this world. Amen? There's all kinds of things. And if I'm not sensitive to the voice of God, I can get myself in trouble. Not from God, but from my own not being sensitive to the Lord. People need to get that. I mean, there's people that really, like I said, we know some things and have really gotten themselves in a mess. And one person even told me, well, you know, I've been laying out a church, I've been doing all this, and I just, and now it's, you know, the world's collapsing. And it's not God doing it. It's not God. Say, oh, did God do this? No, it's not God. It's the devil and the world and all the other junk that's out there. People don't, look, this world's, I describe this fallen world. It's not a fair world. It's a fallen world. And it's like, it's got landmines. And the Holy Ghost wants to protect us from all those landmines. Doesn't mean we'll never go through anything negative. But God wants to warn us. Amen? God will say, well, you know, this is, but, you know, I know I'll use myself. Just drinking more water has changed my life. It really has. I wasn't getting enough water. It's been the second winter in a row. Well, it's not even officially winter yet, but I don't have the mucus problems like I used to. My body was crying for water. Was that God? I believe totally it was God. Totally, God was directing me to change something. Oh, bless God. If God wants it changed, he'll just do it. Sometimes God will direct you to do something different. Amen? We've taken Walton Carroll's example of exercising. I had this attitude, well, walking, that ain't exercise. That's for wimps and, you know, all that stuff. You know, I don't... Yeah, jogging, that's man stuff. No. But you know what I've discovered? It's better if I walk consistently than run inconsistently. And you got to do something to get, your body's made out of how much percentage of water? What happens to water if you don't, if it just sits there? It gets stagnant, becomes a cesspool for all kinds of diseases and stuff. That's common sense. It should be. Well, people think that's not spiritual. That is spiritual. When it says we're blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, Ephesians 1:3, it means that the Spirit's the source of where the blessings come. And when you're led of the Spirit, that's the key. He'll show you what to do. And that's why I said, Lord, show me how to eat. I don't know how to eat. I mean, great. She's awesome and she's helping me. But I just want to eat without putting faith in a diet. That's God. Amen. Amen? See, some people don't think that's God. John. Isn't that good? That's exactly right. Jesus had authority on earth because he was the Son of Man. God, and that's what I'm saying. God's leading and directing us, but the question is, are we listening? We need to turn the world down so we can hear that still small voice. Walton.
I believe God wants to give us information.
Yes.
That we can take that information and change some of the things we're doing so that his healing power can flow through us.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. And chastening seems like, you know...
Pull you through a knothole backwards, no. Right.
The chastening is that he wants to teach us.
Amen.
And now think of that. That's his love.
Yes.
To teach us, and that's information.
Right.
Which then we take
right.
And apply to our lives.
Amen.
So that change can come for the better.
Amen.
And that's not only spiritually, but it's also for our physical body to take care of these temples.
Amen. He'll tell you. Amen. Amen.
I mean,
those are things that God, I know beyond a shadow of a doubt, God is leading us in things, and he'll direct us and correct us, not because he's trying to be mean, but because he loves us. Amen. Amen. Harmless as doves. Amen. Amen. Spirit and life. Amen. Yep. John 6:63. Mm-hmm. Amen. And no, I was going to say, in that word there, it's John 6:63, is rhema, which means the individual spoken word. Logos is the whole of the word, but the rhema is the living voice speaking to you, taking a word from the word or giving you a personal word and directing you. You know, I heard a man say something one time I never forgot. He said that he prayed and God gave him a diet. He said, I'll show you what it is, but it probably won't work for you because it was made for me. Amen. God showed him how he was to lose weight and all that stuff for his particular metabolism. But God wants to direct us all in those types of things because he loves us. And I'm not trying to pick on that, but I'm just saying any area. Well, why is it when... people get mad at me. Well, maybe it's if I wouldn't scream at them all the time, maybe God will show me that. You know what I'm saying? It's those types of things. I believe that the wisdom of God is there. He wants our whole spirit, soul, and body to be preserved blameless. And so that's all facets of life. But the leading comes from the Spirit. Amen? So he says, I know thy works. Oh, go ahead, Anita.
I just think it's neat how, when God shows you something like with food or something.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And he knows that it takes time to change habits.
It does. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know what's amazing? You said something really good. Yeah, he's never going to beat us up. Never. That's not God. But it does say, I know we talk about chastening and it is trial training and all that. I know I'm familiar with the words and Steve Shoup taught an awesome message on that. But I also know if you read that in Hebrews chapter 12, are you ready for this? We don't bring this out, but no chastisement for the moment seems pleasurable. Okay? Yeah, but afterwards it brings forth the peaceable fruits of righteousness. So for the moment, when God corrects me and shows me something I need to be different, it may not seem pleasurable. I don't want to hear that. And see, and this is what I see with people in the situation I was describing earlier that you don't know. This person is like, whenever you can't be taught or you can't have any type of a thing, that's a dangerous place to be. Because I guarantee you, nobody's an island. Not me, not you. I need you. You need me. We need each other. Nobody's an island. And see, some people think, well, see, knowledge, that's what it says in 1 Corinthians 8, that knowledge puffs up. Knowledge, but love edifies. In other words, a lot of times people get knowledge, and I always like to say it like this, they get just enough knowledge to be dangerous, and it puffs them up. And all of a sudden, they start thinking they're all that in three bags of chips. Amen? And no one can talk to them. And that the Bible, that's the pride that precedes the fall that it talks about in Proverbs. And that's dangerous. Go ahead, Jen, you have something?
Oh, no, I just...
Okay. All right, yes, we do. We do need to move on.
You want me to read 1 Corinthians?
Yeah, 15:10. Do that one, and then we'll get back in.
10 or 58?
10.
15:10. Yeah, 58 is good. That's where I thought you were going. Okay. 10. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace which was bestowed upon me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me.
All right, now start verse 20 of Revelation chapter 2. Now, after he commends them, then he says in verse 20, notwithstanding. Now watch what he's correcting them on.
Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and seduce my servants to commit fornication and to eat things sacrificed unto idols.
Isn't this interesting? Jezebel. Jezebel in the Old Testament was the wife of Ahab, a wicked king of Israel. Ahab, I think it's 1 Kings 21 where it talks about there was a Naboth, the Jezreelite, had a vineyard, and you know the story, and some of you do, and Ahab wanted it. And he was all sad because Naboth said, now this has been in my family, we're not getting rid of it. And basically Jezebel gave him wicked counsel and said, you know, we'll just falsely accuse him, have him killed, and the vineyard yours. Well, basically. So Jezebel was an extremely wicked woman. Now in here, this the word Jezebel, I looked it up. It means unchaste, according to a dictionary of scripture proper names by J.B. Jackson, or it means non-cohabitant. And there's a lot of things I could say about that. I believe this is a teaching, whether this was an actual person or this was talking about a spirit, I believe there was a person operating with this, because it says you're allowing this person to teach in your church, and this is not good. I mean, in fact, it's really bad. Here's what I want you to see. What he is correcting them on is wrong teaching. Wrong teaching produces wrong believing, and wrong believing produces a wrong lifestyle. Amen? Most of us, we've come out of a legalistic mindset where we thought God was only relating to us based on how good we were, right? But now we're finding out, no, it's about what Jesus did, and we need to stay, because that doesn't change. It's about what Jesus did. But when he talks about works, he's saying in 1 Corinthians 3, he talks about every man's work. What kind of work is it? I mean, there are rewards for works. Amen? There are good things that can manifest in your life when you go God's way. Amen? God loves you if you smoke, but there's rewards for not smoking. Okay, everybody got that? And there's rewards for that. But it's not God. But he's saying you're allowing this person who calls herself a prophetess. You know, and that's amazing to me. When wrong teaching is allowed, I started thinking about some of the scriptures. You remember Eli, a priest in the Old Testament, 1 Samuel? He had two sons, Hophni and Phinehas. They were wicked. And Eli ended up, his lineage was put out of the priesthood, and there was judgment on Eli because Eli didn't stop his two sons from doing. And he even talked to him and said, hey guys, this ain't a good thing, 1 Samuel chapter 2. This isn't good what I'm hearing of you. You know, I'm hearing of you that you're doing this, but he didn't stop him. And he paid the price for it. And that's what I'm saying there. When we allow things in our life, I say this with kids, and nobody does it perfect. I don't mean it wrong, but Abraham, you read about him in Genesis 18, 19. Read Genesis 18, 19. It's because Abraham commanded his children. And by the way, Abraham was before the law. I just wanted to throw that out there. See, every time you hear a command, it doesn't mean it's law. Command is not a cuss word, okay? In the New Testament, it talks about command, but we just don't do commands to be righteous. It means a precept, a command, et cetera, et cetera. That which is put upon one, a precept that's put upon one because of who he is. That's all it means. In other words, that's why his commandments, I told you, why they're not grievous, because it's who you are. And the main new covenant command, one twofold command, to believe on Jesus and love your brethren. That's it. And it's not to go to heaven or hell. That's not it. He's saying it's basically not putting a bushel over your lit candle, over your spirit man. But read Genesis 18:19.
For I know him, that he will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord, to do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he hath spoken of him.
Realize what it's saying? He's saying, I know Abraham. He'll command his children so I can bring the blessing upon him. Amen? He commands them. In other words, Abraham's in charge. That's not a bad word. You know, I see another thing. Our Western culture as a whole does not understand authority. They don't understand structure. You know, kids say, well, I don't have to listen to that cop. Who's he think he is? You know, stuff like that. And they don't understand that there has to be, I think it's Proverbs 28:2 or something, talks about when you have many leaders, you've got chaos, and that's a paraphrase. There needs to be, even in marriage, men are not better than women. Sorry, guys. I know I've been preaching it for years. But there has to be a structure. There has to be a structure. Amen? We all make the decision. Then you have mass chaos and confusion. Amen? My wife can have an opinion. I'm not going to listen to it, but she can have one. Just kidding. It's like, man, rare. Just kidding. You know, but you know, we work together. We're a team. Amen. But there has to be a structure. Somebody's got to be the head. If you have a two-headed monster, you have a freak. And I think a godly woman, a smart woman, the Bible says, and I don't know why I'm getting on this, but in Proverbs 14:1, a wise woman builds her house, but the foolish plucks it down with her own hands. In other words, well, he's passive. Well, help him be a leader. Amen? That's it. But it's not just in that area. It's in a lot of areas. Go ahead.
Same thing when it comes to God.
Amen.
God is not a Democrat or a Republican.
Amen.
We don't call, let me see if I'm going to choose.
I don't know if I'm going to vote for God this year. Right. That's right. Yeah, he's not a dictator. I mean, and you have a free will. But in God's kingdom, the principles of God's kingdom work only within the kingdom. You know, they don't work out here. I want to take the principles of God and do my own thing. And that's why a lot of people are miserable, Walter.
Well, here's the thing, the way God has got it set up. If the man wants, if the man has enough, what should I say here, without using a crude word?
Mm-hmm. Gumption, yeah.
If a man is a man the way he's supposed to be,
mm-hmm.
And there will be that harmony and unity there together.
Mm-hmm. Amen. That's good. That's good. Praise God. But I don't mean, you know, and even with the whole marriage thing, I'm not trying to get on just that, but I just think it's, for example, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 7, if a one spouse has an unbelieving partner, you know, you just, if they're pleased to dwell with you, that type of thing, you just operate as best you can. We obey the laws of the land unless they trump the law, the standards of God's kingdom. Amen. Whether it's right to obey God or man, we submit to God. But we need to be people that are law-abiding citizens. I mean, that's who we are. Amen. All right, now, I want to say this. And when it says the woman Jezebel, in the Greek it says the woman Jezebel. And notice what she was doing. She was teaching. And I'm debating if I wanted to go more on teachers. But you just read on to verse 21, because I'm trying to get this done.
And I gave her space to repent of her fornication, and she repented not.
Now, I do not believe this is physical fornication. I believe it's spiritual, because I believe that. But a lot of times you will notice, and you read back in the Old Testament, and you notice all the heathen cults, there was always a lot of sexual sin, physical sexual sin. But there's also a spiritual type of fornication, which is consistent with the book of Revelation. When it says, I gave her space to repent or to change her mind and change her actions, it's interesting. The word space is the Greek word chronos, like where we get chronology, and it refers to time and sequence. But here's what I want you guys to see, because a lot of people don't see this, and it's all over the New Testament. And I can show you many places in the New Testament, but there is judgment, not... how do I want to say? What I do matters. Amen? And if I don't go God's way, the Bible says in, I believe it's 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19 on down, he says, if a man purges himself of certain things, then he'll be fit for the master to use. God can use me if I purge myself of certain things. That's one of my prayers is, Lord, make me usable. I used to think I was usable. I'm like, God, can't you see? Haven't you seen how great I am? Now, I know none of you ever thought like that. I say, I do. I pray, Lord, make me usable. Teach me to teach. Teach through me. Help, Lord. I need you to do this because I can't do it. Amen. I think the reason God can't use a lot of people is because they're not broke. They still think they got it going on in their heart. That's why it says he tries the reins in the hearts. See, there's a desire in every believer to be used of God. Did you know that? Nobody was created to coast. I tell people, Adam and Eve had a job before the fall. Adam was tending the garden before the fall. We were designed to do something. Amen? But that's why I say this mindset that people get that, well, bless God, I'm under grace. And then they get sloppy. That's insanity. That's not the grace of God at all. But that's what he's talking about here. He says, and I gave her space to repent of her fornication. And here's what I want to say. There is judgment from God, especially upon teachers that hurt God's people, that put them back under the law and do these types of things. There is. Go to Revelation chapter 22. I've showed you this before, but look at it. Chapter 22, verse 17. Go ahead. Read this.
And the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely.
Keep going.
For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him
the plagues that are written in this
book.
Did you realize what he's saying? God will do it. And I take issue with some people that don't believe that because that's what the Word of God says. He's talking about people that add to the Word of God. If I come here and start adding to the Word of God and start, the Bible says God will add into him. You know why? This is my own theory. I believe the reason is because I'm adding to what Jesus did. Therefore, if Jesus didn't pay for it, then if I'm going to teach people that God himself takes that very personally when we hurt God's people. Yeah, look at the next one. Oh, go ahead. Yeah. Yeah. There's a difference. And you can go to 1 Corinthians 3 and cover that. Because it says, let every man take heed. And he's talking to teachers how he builds upon the foundation of Jesus Christ in verse 11. If he builds wood, hay, stubble, gold, silver, precious stone. If any man, every man's work, what he taught will be tried. For the day shall try it. It'll be tried by fire. But if a man goes so far as to defile the temple of God, the Bible says, him will God destroy. And that's specifically talking about teachers in the body of Christ. That's why it says, be not many masters or teachers, James chapter 3, verse 1, knowing we're going to receive a stricter judgment because what you share with people. I fear for some of these guys. The fear of the Lord, I mean, God's not mad at you, but there is a judgment for teachers that go around and abuse God's people. I mean, it's all over the New Testament. You can't get away from it. Are they saved? Well, I believe they are because it says in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 1, that there were false prophets also among, literally in the people, Old Testament, even as there shall be false teachers in you who shall privily bring in alongside damnable heresies, saying no or denying the Lord that bought them. And the Lord showed me one time, he said, these people are saved. And it says, and many shall follow their pernicious ways by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of. And it says they'll bring the judgment upon themselves. John.
I believe that's why when your works are tried as if by fire.
Right.
Things that are worthless will burn up.
Absolutely.
And that's why he has to supernaturally wipe right. away our tears, because we saw what we blew
it. Yep. 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 That's exactly right. Dawson. Right.
But I'm thinking Paul talked about having the understanding
right.
more than God knowledge.
Right.
One thing to know, but if you don't have the proper understanding, right. like what we're learning now,
right.
the proper understanding,
necessary.
That's where you get off
Amen.
Here by adding to and coming up with all these other yep. different man-made
right.
theology, or whatever you want to call it.
Yep, that's good. Good.
Coming back to understanding, what's interesting, I was taking a shower yesterday.
We were praying that would happen. I'm just kidding. Oh, no, I'm just kidding. Sorry, John. Sorry, John. Go ahead. John's like, now he's paranoid. Yeah. Yeah. Go ahead. You were taking a shower.
A circumstance came up to me. Like, it was a year ago, upcoming this weekend. We had some folks come in, and we put them up.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Put them up in a suite. We provided everything for a weekend. And they got here about 8-10 hours later than they were supposed to. And they left earlier than they were going to. And what's really strange about it is I was thinking about that. And Karen and I, we were hurt over this. You know, I mean, it hurt our feelings because we did all this for them. Mm-hmm. And it didn't seem to be appreciated. Yeah. What's interesting is what the Lord showed me was that all they had to do was show up and enjoy themselves.
Right.
That's it.
Yeah.
Food, everything was provided. Everything.
Mm.
And that's the way we are.
Come on.
We get born again.
That's so good.
And we don't understand
there you go.
That everything has been provided for us.
That's,
and
we don't partake.
Realize it.
Yeah.
We walk around anxious and worked up over
yeah.
stuff.
That doesn't matter.
That doesn't matter.
Right. Right, right.
Glory to God, you're standing there taking a shower and this comes to you all of a sudden.
We're trying to, the moral of the story is take more showers. No, but seriously, that's true. And I find another thing that people constantly try to live the future in the now. You know, like for example, this week has been very busy for me. But you know, I can only do one thing at a time. That's it. And you know, you get a schedule, you just do it one at a time, and just enjoy the moment. Yeah, take today to day. I mean, it's like you're trying, oh, you know, perfect example. If you've ever drove a bus route, you get this route, you're subbed, you have no idea where you're going. You get this route, you get to the next place one at a time. You get a general idea where you're going, and just take it, and you can do that in things in life. But we try to carry the whole load, and we can't do that. And I mean, I think that's a big secret to not living with the cares and the weight. Enjoy the moment. God is right now. God loves you. And I challenge you just to eat. Well, I got this going on. But God, you're not just a normal person, man. You are a child of the King. You are empowered. The Creator of the universe lives in you. I mean, you've got a special access that other people don't have. You're not an ordinary mortal. Amen. You're the initiated into God's special favor. Amen. Yep. That's it. And he says, my people. New Testament counterpart, 2 Corinthians 4:3, in whom the gospel is hid, it is hid to those that are lost. But that's the old King James. That's not good. It says, if our gospel be veiled. It is, read the New American Standard, it is veiled to those who are perishing or experiencing destruction. He's not talking about people out in the world, although it could include that, but he's talking about people in the body of Christ that can't see Christ.
They reject the truth.
And like John said, everything was available, everything's provided for, but then people don't see that. And see, and this is where wrong doctrine, like what the Church of Thyatira. When that comes in, I mean, I think it's interesting that she calls herself a prophetess. Why are you saying that? All right, do you believe in prophecy? I believe in legitimate New Testament prophecy. But I have noticed the propensity of people that are prophets or prophetesses. And you know what the Lord showed us one time? He said a lot of people that do that use that as a cover for being very illiterate in the word. So they always got to give you a word. I'm not against that if it's legit. There is a legit. Please don't throw the baby out with the bath. But I'm saying a lot of times, well, I'm always giving Walt a word. I'm always giving you a word. But I have very little word, get very nervous and get away. Amen? Because everything, this is God speaking to me. Revelation from the Bible is God revealing Jesus to me. Will he give me a word about a situation in my life or whatever? Absolutely. But it will never contradict this. And a lot of people want to get words above the word. They put words in place of the word, and then you have error. And I think it's interesting that she calls herself. It doesn't say she is a prophetess, but she calls herself a prophetess. You had something, Lois?
Oh, just that we see through a glass.
Yeah, 1 Corinthians 13, at the present time. And once again, that's why it's important. We need each other. We need to pray for each other. We need to, I think sometimes, what if, you know how we get consumed with our own world? What if I was consumed with someone else's world as much as I get? Because, you know, we can live like that. Because it ain't about me, it's about Jesus. I even like saying that. It's about Jesus. That's good news.
Give a quick, what is spiritual fornication?
Well, I believe it's mixing. If you read back in the book of Revelation, it's mixing law and grace. It's mixing teaching with what Christ has done. And when I say law, I'm not just talking about obvious law. There's all kinds of laws or standards that we put in place of what of Jesus. And when you do that, that's spiritual fornication. And it says even as you get back in there that all nations have been drunk of the wine of her fornication. The wine of her, she's talking about Mystery Babylon. Well, I want to get into some of this stuff. I want to even get into some things that might blow you guys away on Thursday nights. I want to talk about a third part. You ever heard a third part? Yeah, I know. I need to say a third part of the world, World War III. I want to get into some of that and show you what the Bible says. But yes, sir.
Okay, spiritual fornication. You know, correct me. This is what I think it is in my mind.
Mm-hmm.
And please understand where I come from. I was a Roman Catholic.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, and they believe when the priest does this and that, it turns into the little
transubstantiation. Yep.
And then see, they have our communion, and that's what they believe.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I think the way it is the truth. This is the Bible.
Amen.
And I go back to that church, and I participate with those guys.
Yep.
And I do all that. I mean, to me, that's spiritual fornication.
Yep.
I'm committing spiritual fornication.
Yep.
Is that correct?
Absolutely. That's a good example.
Well, that's the way I speak.
Well, and the thing of it is,
going back to that stuff and committing adultery with that.
Yeah. You can be nice to people. You can be nice to people without partaking of that type of stuff. I mean, you know what I'm saying? It's one thing to be nice, but if you start, like I know people that, without picking on the Catholic Church, but when I go there for like, because I get my family that are Catholic, I don't take communion, I don't do any of that because I'm not part of that. You know, I won't do that. I mean, I'll be nice. I'm not a jerk. I'm not trying to do any of that stuff, but I won't do that. We're going to try to finish this quick. Go ahead, Jen. Not, it won't be quick, but I will kill.
Verse 22. Behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. And I will kill her children with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he which searcheth the reins and hearts. And I will give unto every one of you according to your works.
Obviously, these verses are loaded. And when you read this stuff, you think, well, that don't sound like grace. but you know, he's talking about teachers. And he's talking about this Jezebel, this mixing of the covenant, spiritual fornication, and those types of things. And when it talks about children, it's the Greek word technon. And one of the definitions is in the New Testament, it's pupils or disciples are called children of their teachers because the latter, by their instruction, nourish the minds of their pupils and mold their character. In other words, and it could be that, and also it could be just the fruit of her ways, of all that type. But my point in saying all that, he says, as I search the reins and the hearts, literally the inmost thoughts. That's why it's so important to have our hearts purged, not from sin, but from dead works. It's already been purged from sin because of what Jesus has done. But purge, Hebrews 9:14, from dead works so we can effectively serve the living God. In other words, we follow our nature. Amen? I mean, this is, like I said, sometimes with the book of Revelation, I know why some people stay away from it, because they think, wow, it's a hard book, because there are things, it's symbolic language, but I believe God is saying that teachers are going to be held to a higher standard, which is confirmed throughout Scripture, because they have the ability to steer people into life or steer them away from life. Amen. Okay, but we're trying to hurry.
Verse 24. But unto you I say, and unto the rest in Thyatira, as many as have not this doctrine, and which have not known the depths of Satan, as they speak, I will put upon you none other burden, but that which ye have already, hold fast till I come.
Okay, there's a lot that's said here. It says, but unto you I say, and to the rest in Thyatira, as many as have not this doctrine, I will put upon you none other burden. And it has to do with the burden that they were dealing with was the burden of dealing with the results of this teaching that was going on in the body of Christ, that was going on in their particular church, I should say. And I believe God's saying, I'm not going to put on you anything else, but unto you that, and the rest of you that have not this doctrine. See, you know what it tells me? How important is doctrine? How important is it what we believe? I mean, Jen and I were talking tonight out of the scripture, I think it's Luke 11:35, it's also Matthew 6, where it talks about, is about, take heed that the light that is in you be not darkness. Do you realize how strong that is? He's saying, Jesus is saying, be careful that the light of what I believe isn't really darkness. And then it's in Matthew's account, he says, if the light that is in you is darkness, how great is that darkness? And so this tells me that doctrine is huge. Go ahead.
My eyes were bad. I did not see the gospel. I couldn't see it. I thought of myself. I had to somehow maintain my own righteousness. Mm. I had no righteousness of my own.
So it's impossible. Absolutely. Absolutely. Righteous, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
It'll literally destroy you.
It will.
But once I had the eye sap, now my eyes are good.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
It's like a little hamster in one of them wheels.
Yeah.
It goes nowhere.
Yeah. Right. And when it talks about to those that have not this doctrine, it's interesting. In doctrine, it means to those who have not embraced or been contaminated with this doctrine. I think it's interesting. To those who have not embraced and been contaminated with this doctrine. And I here again, it's pretty amazing. But it says, go ahead, read verse 25 and then stop. I'm trying to hurry.
But that which ye have already, hold fast till I come. That's going to 26. Verse 26. Yes, and he that overcometh and keepeth my works until the end, to him will I give power over the nations.
It's interesting. And it says, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. But I want to get to that. The word keepeth there is the Greek word tereo, and it means to keep one in the state in which he is. It means to guard. To keep one in the state in which he is. John. Okay. To keep one in the state in which he is. Go ahead, Emerson.
You talk about that, and he that overcometh.
Yeah. Yeah, overcometh. I've said this. All seven churches, when it talks about overcoming, it's all seven is in the present tense, which simply means it's a continuous action. Overcoming isn't like I used to think, like I had to somehow be good enough to overcome. Overcoming is 1 John 5:4. I refer to it often. This is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. Faith in what? Faith in who? Faith in Jesus and what he's done. So overcoming is a matter of putting your faith in him and keeping your faith in him. That's what it means to overcome. It's not trying harder. It's not pulling yourself up by your bootstraps. It's keeping your faith in him. It says, it's amazing to me. It says, hold on, I'm gonna finish this verse. It says, he that overcometh and overcometh what? In this church, anybody know? Wrong doctrine. Wrong doctrine. How many people don't overcome wrong doctrine? I've literally talked to people about many times about Jesus. Man, it's all about what Jesus did. Oh, amen. Man, it's all about what Jesus did. And the next breath, they're back. They can't even hear the difference. You know, you need to thank God that you can hear the new covenant. Because even sharing some of this, I mean, I understand that, you know, what some of it's, but you know, we got to deal with it. It's in the Word. I mean, and God takes it very seriously when people get up and hurt his people. I mean, some of the things people teach on, you know, even on Christian TV is just absolutely pathetic. It's sickening. And I think there's a judgment for that. If they're born again, they're going to heaven, but there is a judgment for that, according to Scripture, because you're adding to. And it says if you take away, and I didn't get to that part in Revelation 22, whosoever takes away from this doctrine, this teaching, this prophetic word of Jesus, whoever takes away, God will take away his part out of the book of life. Now stop. That can't mean he's going to hell, because how could he get in the book of life? Think with me. God took away his part out of the book of life because of him taking away from the finished work of Jesus. Wow. That's strong. But that's what it says. And that's what it's teaching. And it's consistent with the rest of Scripture. New covenant. And that's why teachers, you know, I wonder, what is this stricter judgment that teachers will receive? Well, I think we're seeing it. I think, you know, that we can't allow. I'm very particular who I have sit in this pulpit. I am not jealous. I'm really not. And I want people, I'm not saying I've never dealt with jealousy. We all have. But I'm saying I'm not like one of those people that, well, you know, you don't want to have people, anybody get up in your pulpit. They might preach better than you. Well, good. Good. Amen. But it's about what they're sharing. if it's going to put people back under the law and back under confusion. Hey, and listen, nobody says everything perfect. I mean, it's not like, we've got this big selection, but we're getting more. I mean, I'm excited about Ed Elliott. I'm really hoping to get Ed Elliott here because he will bless your socks off. I mean, the love of God, you'll hear it. It'll just encourage you so much. Very good. But anyhow, I'm going to try to finish this. We're just a little over. We're hurrying. But that which he that overcometh, so overcoming is putting our faith in him and keeps my, notice it's whose works it is. It's not your works, it's his works. That's the difference. See, Christianity isn't you living for God. It's you allowing God to live through you. See, the essence of man's religion is you live for God. It's what it is. True Christianity, Paul said, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, but it's not me, it's Christ living in me. The life I live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. True Christianity is not you living for God, but you letting him live through you. All right. But that which you have already, but he that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations. I've just got to hurry and say this. To the end. I've meditated on it. Does that mean the end of this life and they're going to rule in the millennial and all that stuff? I don't believe that's what it's talking about. Leave it in context. I believe, if you back up, it says, I gave her space to repent of her fornication. I believe there was a time period where they were going to have to deal with this situation because of what it was doing to their church. The pastor was going to have to deal with this wrong doctrine. But if you hold fast, if you overcome and you keep my works, if you guard them, it means to guard, keep one in the state of which he is, to him will I give power or exousia or authority over the nations. He'll be able to walk in the power that he is because, see, wrong doctrine can contaminate you. A little leaven leavens the whole lump, Galatians 5:9. And he shall rule them. I'm just going to hurry since it's later than it's ever been. And he shall rule them with a rod of iron. Once again, talking about authority. And as the vessels of potter shall they be broken to shivers, even as I've received of my Father. When I think of that, I think of we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. And he shall, and I believe that's what, you know, that's the best I can get there. But it definitely talks about he's going to have authority. Here's what I'm after. I want to say something about the morning star. And I will give him the morning star. Do you know there's the morning star and the day star? What do you think's the difference? Or is there a difference? Morning precedes the day. Jesus is called the day star in 2 Peter chapter 1. Jesus is called the day star. But watch this. I want to read this. I found this. This is Adam Clark's commentary. It says, and I will give to him the morning star. I'll let you read it.
He shall have the brightest and most glorious empire next to that of Christ himself. And it is certain that the Roman Empire under Constantine the Great was the brightest emblem of the latter day glory, which has ever yet been exhibited to the world. It is well known that sun, moon, and stars are emblems in prophetic language of empires, kingdoms, and states. And as the morning star is that which immediately precedes the rising of the sun, it probably here intends an empire which should usher in the universal sway of the kingdom of Christ.
That's what I'm after, is that last verse. It says, And as the morning star, and Christ talks about the day star, I believe it means as the morning star is that which immediately precedes the rising of the sun, it probably, and here again, we don't know, but this is the best we got so far, it probably here intends an empire which should usher in the universal sway of the kingdom of Christ. I believe that when he says, I will give him the morning star, that he's in a position to begin to declare the day star. Because he's operating in the authority. He's preparing people. John the Baptist came to prepare the way for Christ. Amen? And I believe that as we overcome and as we walk in what God has given us, we're preparing the way for Christ in the lives of people. Can you hear that? All right, now hold on. I want to finish this. And I will give him the morning star. And then, of course, verse 29, he that hath an ear. Do you have an ear? Feel your head. It's not talking about a physical ear. It's talking about a spiritual ear. Let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. And by the way, the Church of Thyatira is like 12 verses. It's the longest dissertation given to any of the seven churches. So anyhow, there's a lot of history there too. But Lois, you had something?
Yes.
Go ahead. Mm-hmm. Studious.
Strong together.
Mm.
Strong together. Because, the wolf can come in.
Right.
And the shepherd may be there, but we are responsible.
Amen.
We are responsible to be just strong for each other.
Amen. Like, pray for one another.
Yeah.
And love them. Yep.
Right there.
Do you realize how powerful your prayers are? Like when you just make mention of people in your prayer, do you realize that authority goes out? I'm serious. And when you say in the name of Jesus, I lift up Chris and Jennifer, or Walt and Carol, or John and Sandy, or whoever. When you do that, you're releasing authority because you have authority in the name of Jesus. Amen. What I see with these seven churches as I've been looking at all of them and studying, I see one of the main concerns that God has is wrong teaching. I really do. I see that because even people, see, people think works don't matter. They do matter. That's why he says, I'm going to try your works. Notice he doesn't say I'm going to try your grace. I'm going to try your works. And it's not saying, well, you're going to go to heaven. If you're born again, you're going to heaven. Amen. But God wants us to live the fullness of everything that he's provided. Amen.
That's like the teacher teaching us and then we take the test. That would be
yeah. Yep. Yeah, well, like I said, the grace produces in a person's life. It really will produce. But anyhow, like I said, I understand, and I alluded to it earlier. You can flip that off if you want, Debbie. Thank you. I alluded to it earlier because some of these things I get really excited about, even getting back through the